Even James Marshall. Good evening, Tiffany Sutton, Sonia Ford, Anthony. Finest, the Boss Parkinson. Good evening. How's everybody doing this evening? Mr. Louis Straub, Jacqueline Burrell, Renee Gant. Miss Gant, how you doing? Bobby Pettis, how you doing? Good evening, Adrian Carter. Good evening, good evening. Right. All right. Miss McKnight, Lakeisha McKnight, Ronald Newton, Miss Dr. P. Raheeling, Jamal King. Good evening, Connie Dismuke, Darren Dismuke, Brayton. Good evening, Mr. Socho. Good evening. Hey, Eddie Lee in Boston, Massachusetts. I'll be in the Northeast, the Great Northeast, this weekend. Hey, Greg and Dion Stevens. Kalito Muhammad, assalamu alaikum. Ricardo Hamilton. Good evening, good evening, good evening. Want to be free. Hey, Trina Purdue James. Good evening. All right, Dante Taylor, we're going to start this call. I can't believe I'm on time tonight, so you know I was waiting. I was fired up. Hey, Delisha.
Good evening, everyone, and welcome to the Wednesday Night Freedom Call with Mr. Ty and Mrs. Valerie Beth, and we are excited that you're here with us this evening. But before we get started, please state your name and where you are calling from.
All participants are unmuted.
Hey, Classy T. Brown, Ryan Foster, Janine Hunter, Reagan McKay, Sheila Goat, Miss King, Darren Dismute, Dwayne Clark.
Well, good evening, Mr. Beth. How are you, sir?
I'm outstanding, Mr. Berger, and how are you?
I see that you're connected with us. Oh, you may be setting up
here. I'm sorry. I got us on mute, Mr. Berger. I'm just talking away. How are you this evening?
I am outstanding, sir. How are you, sir?
Outstanding, outstanding. We got a full live stream going, man. I was here 5 minutes early today, man. I'm trying to turn on a new leaf. I'm working on it. I was ready to go at 10:15. So, I said to myself, you can change, Tyrone. You don't have to be running. You can change. Just stop trying to do so much at one time. Get yourself ready for this call. So, thank you very much, sir. Love the music in the beginning. Of course, that cranks me up. So, you're doing okay. All right. Well, look, folks, tonight I really gave some thought and did just a little bit of research, not much, just a little bit of research, which I'm always doing all the time anyway. And tonight I want to talk about closing the wealth gap. And the reason I want to talk about closing the wealth gap, that's the gap between the wealthy or the haves and the have-nots, okay? And I'm going to try not to get too emotional about it, too fired up. I'm going to try to stay as clear, succinct as I possibly can and give a few facts and really talk about why Carrot Bars International is the solution, is the immediate solution, okay? So I'm going to give it one more minute, give folks time to join us on the live stream, Mr. Berger, before I get into this thing, folks, but you know, we know there's a serious wealth gap in America, and the gap has widened over the last 50 years. It's incredible what's going on. But those of us, many of you, probably 89% of the folks who are watching this stream, it's sort of like I'm preaching to the choir because you already know that Carrot Bars is a solution. Okay, so greeting all the folks who are joining us on the call, Ms. Morgan, McIntyre, Elliot Jackson, Christopher Shelfield, Mr. Bernie Treadwell, Lord Lynch, Karen Briggs, Janine Hunter, Dan Shipp, Laretha Shelton, good evening. Ira, good evening. Deborah, Harris, Roberts, good evening to all those folks who are joining. So let me get right into this little message I wanted to give. And I know we talk about it all the time. You know, Bishop Sutton say what he called Wealth Builders Worldwide as Wealth Builders University. And I do believe that we are a financial university online. And I believe we have some of the greatest financial minds in the world on this team, not mine, on this team, that are sharing information with people and helping to educate people financially in a way most people in their entire lives have not been educated. So let me talk about this wealth gap a little bit. First, we got to understand, what is this gap? This, when we talk about the wealth gap, and you're going to hear more and more people talk about it in the media, because one of the things that frustrate me is people starting to talk about this, and I believe that people starting to talk about it because they see this as an opportunity to walk around and pretend to be teaching something about this wealth gap and talking about how it exists. But they see this as an opportunity. But the wealth gap has been here for the last 35 years. I saw networking as a way of closing the wealth gap 35 years ago, because what I saw when I saw this business was an opportunity for the average person like myself, with no resources, no background, no business background, no pedigree, or whatever you might call it, to start from zero. Didn't have to go borrowing the money. Didn't have to go to the Small Business Administration. Didn't have to go to the banks. Didn't have to go to my relatives and friends. I could start with zero and build wealth. That's what I saw 35 years ago. And I knew there was a wealth gap then, because I knew there was the have and the have nots. Okay. But I truly didn't understand everything I was embarking on at that time. But I got a great understanding of it today, and I'm on a mission. And yes, my mission is to free people from a system of debt and to help build wealth. But I didn't understand how important it was till I started reading more and more about this wealth gap that truly, truly exists. I understood it, but not the way I understand it now, because I understand the numbers. So what is, we said wealth gap. Wealth gap is not cash flow. Okay? One of the biggest mistakes that so many people make in this business or in life is they have cash flow, and they think because they have cash flow, they have money. They think because they have some cash coming in, maybe it's $5,000 a month, or $10,000 a month, or $20,000 a month, you can feel you've made it on any amount of money. If you've been dirt, broke, and destitute all your life, you get a job paying you $2,000 a month, you think you've made it. And if not careful, you'll be satisfied there. You can get to $5,000 a month, where if you've been broke all your life, you think you've made it. You can get to $10,000 a month, where if you've been broke all your life, you think you've made it. And you'll pull back the throttle and chill out. Okay? But wealth is not cash flow. That's why you can find so many professional athletes who made a lot of money, end up broke. You find entertainers who made a lot of money, end up broke. You find authors, writers, people, all kinds of back who made a lot of money, had a great cash flow, live a great lifestyle, end up broke. Sammy Davis Jr. made hundreds of millions of dollars in his lifetime and died with no money. Okay? Leaving LTV's $26 million in debt. So, because he didn't have assets. Okay? And we can go on and on. I'm not trying to pick on Sammy Davis Jr. because, believe it or not, he's one of my idols. One of the things that taught me to dream. Because I read his book, Yes, I Can, when I was 14 years old. I read Sammy Davis Jr.'s book, and it made me believe that I could do something extraordinary with my life, because he was a guy, and the time he was born and raised, one of the most talented people ever walk on this planet, made millions of dollars, still died broke. So the name of the game, folks, is learning how to accumulate assets so that when you do pass away, you can leave something to your family. So when we say wealth gap, we're talking about those with assets and those with nothing. Okay, an asset. And one of the first things people learned in Wealth Builders Worldwide when they enter into the world of Carabas is the difference between an asset and a liability. And most people don't know this, but an asset, to quote Candace Parkinson at 7 years old, says an asset puts money in your pocket and a liability takes money out of your pocket. Okay, we've been led to believe our home's an asset. Everybody walk around talking about, I bought a home. And we've been led to believe that it is an asset. When in actuality, it's an asset on the bank's book. It's a liability on your books. That's an important distinction to make. And most people don't realize that the house is a liability until they've owned the house 5 or 10 years and find their cash flow interrupted. And then the bank promptly reminds them who owns the home. It takes about 30, 60 days, but the bank will come in and say, you know, we own this home. We have the title to this home. You have the mortgage. And as Mr. Delk has educated us to understand, mortgage what? Root word is mortician, come from what? Meaning Delf debt. That's where it comes from. You got a 30-year mortgage, that's a Delf debt. And I don't want to get into how many banks and mortgage companies right now are trying to steal people's homes because they owe $500 of tax on a home or $1,000 of tax on a home. Or better yet, they paid home for 27 years and now all of a sudden they find themselves not being able to finish off their mortgage and the bank wants to swoop in and steal that asset when that person's paid for all that. That's not what we're here to talk about, because I can go off and I get, you think I see, ooh, and then let me stop. Stay on point, Tyrone. Assets and liabilities, okay? An asset is something that grows in value, that has at least the potential to grow in value, okay? It may not always grow in value, but it has the potential to grow in value. And most of all our lives, we've been taught to spend our money on liabilities. A car is a liability. You may look good, you may smell good in that car, but it's a flat out liability and it's an expense. And I can go into hours about buying cars. I mean, logic says this: the best value is to buy a used car, and still millions of new cars are sold every single year. But you can go buy a car that got 10,000 miles on it, brand spanking new, 1 year old, as good as a car, but we still like new cars. We like that new car smell. We like saying, I'm the only owner of this car. All that psychological in our mind, but we're literally throwing away tens of thousands of dollars when we do it. But now you have the right to do that. But understand that car is a liability too, until you have the title in your hand. When you have the title in your hand, now it's an asset. And that asset is based on what that car is worth at that time. So assets and liabilities is what determines the wealth gap. Okay? And the wealth gap have widened. Now let me give you a few stats that'll blow your mind. The average European family, white family in America, their net worth is over $200,000, around $240,000. That may vary from community to community, state to state, but they say the average. I was just reading, I looked it up right before I got on this call just to make sure one more time. $240,000. That's an asset. That's the average white family's assets in America. $240,000. The average African-American or Latino's family net worth in the same country is $4,000. I'm going to say it one more time. $240,000 versus $4,000. I've been saying for 30 years that minorities, we are the wheels of the economy. We keep the economy afloat. We keep the economy going. Why? Because in African-American community, talking about, we got $1.1 trillion that flows through our hands every single year. And we spend most of it on entertainment, movies, theater, cars, wheels, and clothes, and travel, and having fun. Because we don't know the difference between an asset and a liability. But that's changing because of Carabao's International and Wealth Builders Worldwide. It's changing every community. But don't understand something. This is not a racial thing. Don't look at it as a racial thing. They say the gap between the wealthy, okay, and the working class have widened. In fact, it's increased more in the last 50 years than it did in the 50 years prior. In the last 50 years, okay, they said 1% of the nation right now owns 50% of the nation's net worth. 1% of the population owns 50% of the net worth in this country right now. Okay? They say about 20%, the top 20% own 86% of the net worth. 20% own 86%. And then I read the stat further. They said, really, to break it down and really understand, you got 7% of the net worth in this country being shared by 80% of the population. And by the way, I submit to you, that's not necessarily the wealth's fault. It might be the banker's might have a contributing factor, but some of that has to do with the way we perceive money and what we do with our money, as well as the fact that they condition us to be consumers, not asset and net worth builders. Okay? There's a report out that said that if African Americans continue on this trend, by the year 2050, our average net worth in the average home of the average African American will be zero. By 2050. Okay? We're talking about some 20, talking about 30 years from now. The average, after all the civil rights movement, all the marching, all the legislation, all the affirmative action programs, all the get a good job program, all the look good, smell good, work for a major corporation program, after all that stuff, 30 years from now, the net worth in the black community will still be zero, because many of us sold out to looking good, smelling good, and we got two cars in the drive when we think we've arrived, and we're still dying, not leaving a legacy or even anything, or haven't built anything worthwhile to leave to our family, our kids, or our grandkids. Because no matter how much IBM pay you, or Xerox pay you, or Ford Motor Company, General Motors, or any one of those Fortune 500 pay you, you can't leave your job to your grandkids. You can leave them some money if you manage that money properly. But the stats say that's not what we're doing. The stats say we're looking good. And I say we, I mean a lot of people. I'm not talking about one particular African. I mean most people want to look good. America wants to sell us on the idea of looking good. Sell us on the idea of looking successful. Sell us on the idea of acting successful, but not actually being successful. That's a whole nother seminar. I'm not going to get too deep into that. Right now, it's in the city of Boston, the average net worth of the average family in Boston is $240,000 in the city of Boston right now. Average net, this is reported by the Boston Globe, $240,000. The average black family's net worth in the city of Boston right now, $8. We're talking about one of the most wealthiest, educated cities in the country, $8. Okay? So, folks, there is a wealth gap, but there is a solution. We have the solution. We have the solution, and it's called Carrot Bars International. And that's the mission you're on, folks. You may not understand it. That's how big this is. And people ask me, why do I go 5, 6, 7 years? Why the value I work this thing like we do? Because it's bigger than just the money. Okay? Okay? This is an opportunity whose time has come. What Mr. Harold Seitz has done, it put us all in a position to close that gap. Every individual on this call can close that gap, can work towards closing that gap between the have and the have-nots. Okay? Anyway, why? Because we can acquire assets. Now, what's an asset? Property is an asset when you own the property and the bank don't own it. Carrot Bars puts you in a position to own that property, to pay off your mortgage, literally to buy a property with no mortgage. You and that person, I'm going to talk about that in a minute. Okay, but what things can you accumulate? People say, well, what can I accumulate that's an asset? Well, number one, you can't accumulate land, or you can't accumulate property. That property with a mortgage on it is not an outright asset. Now, you may have some asset in that property. You get a $300,000 mortgage, you put $100,000 down, you got $100,000 in that property. And it's an asset. If you can sell it for $300,000, take out $100,000, you got $100,000 asset. You understand that? Okay, but a property can be an asset. But literally, as many as 60-70% of us are not in a position to what? To buy that property or to get that mortgage to accumulate and get that asset. See, the game that was played with us throughout the 70s and 80s was, hey, buy a house because inflation is giving you the perception that you are actually making a good decision. You buy a house for $100,000 and inflation takes that house to $150,000. You say, I made a $50,000. Well, you know, and most of us walked around in the 70s and 80s and thought we'd done that. I bought a house in Georgia for $130,000. It grew to worth $220,000. Woo! Looked like I had made some money. But when I started to understand inflation, hadn't made anything at all. Hadn't really made any progress at all. It's a trick. It's a lie. It's deception. But it's a true asset if you have the title. No matter what the house is, it goes up or goes down. If it's worth $90,000, you own the title, you have a $90,000 asset. But most of us are not in a position. Most people, not us, most people, when I say us, I mean people in general, are not in a position to acquire the asset, mortgage. So here comes Carrot Bars. The reason Carrot Bars is so vital to what we're doing around the world is you can start accumulating an asset right now. today, tonight. For those who are on this call for the first time, be invited by a relative or a friend, Carrot Bars International put you in a position to do what? To acquire an asset, because you're either going to acquire land as an asset or you're going to acquire precious metals. And the number one precious metal to acquire is gold, because gold is recognized as money all around the world. So when you set up your free gold savings account, you're not saving dollars anymore. You're not saving fiat currency anymore anywhere in the world. Now you're saving a true asset that has the potential to appreciate. That's what Dr. Harold Seitz has done, has put the masses of people in a position to now start acquiring an asset and closing that gap 1 gram at a time. See, the wealth has always known gold as an asset. That's why they priced the average person out of the marketplace so they couldn't get it. You want a gold account? Great. Give us $25,000 to start buying gold by the ounce, or wait a minute, or by the troy ounce. If you can't participate in the game, you can't save real money. But Carrot Bars put the average person in position to save real money and to start accumulating asset. Whether you live in your car, whether you live in an apartment, whether you live in your own home, you got your own mortgage, doesn't matter where you are, in 141 countries, you can now start accumulating what is recognized around the world as a true asset with the potential to accumulate, to grow as an asset. When I got involved in Carrot Bars in November of 2013, gold was $1,100 an ounce. Now it's around $1,500 an ounce. Okay, that's a 25 to 30% appreciation. That's just math, folks. I didn't have anything to do with it. I didn't make it happen. The marketplace, I didn't have anything to do with it. That's the market demand for gold. That's what you have in your hands. 1 gram at a time. And so this is why what we do, this mission we have to eliminate debt from people's lives, is bigger than what we're thinking about. We're in a position right now to close the gap, the wealth gap all around the world for anybody, regardless of their religion, background, ethnicity, all of that. It don't matter. You start accumulating gold, you're closing that gap between the haves and the have-nots, and you can start right now tonight. You don't have to go get a loan. You don't have to start your business on the corner. You don't have to go borrow some money from friends. You can start right now for free and start saving your gold. Not just in a gram anymore. When I started 6 years ago, you can start saving gold 1/10 of a gram at a time. Okay? And then Dr. Harold Seitz says, not only can you start a saving gold and build that asset, we're going to give you another opportunity. A secret opportunity, but you can tell everybody you want to. And that opportunity, we're going to start allowing you to acquire cryptocurrency, which is a potential appreciating asset, but we're going to let you get it at pennies. And that asset could go to $1, could go to $5, could go to $10. We know a well-known cryptocurrency out there that went to $20,000 a coin, backed by nothing. We don't know who the owner was. We don't know anything about that coin. And that coin still right now is trading at, I don't know, $8,000 a coin. We got a coin backed by gold. We know the owner. We know the CEO. We know the corporate headquarters. And we got 8 years of track record behind that coin. Oh, my God. That's a second asset you can start acquiring right now. And many of us got the asset in the last year and a half. We got the asset for less than a penny. People come and ask, well, it's only at 2-3 cents. Yeah, but you got it for less than a penny. What's the problem? That means it's still an asset. I got a guy on my team sold somewhere near 2 million coins because he needed $20,000. Well, he got $20,000. Now, I mean, he might regret that later on, but it was still an asset that this person could liquidate and put $20,000 in his pocket to handle a situation that was going on right now. And if it wasn't for Carrot Bars, would not have been in a position to do that. I hope you understand how incredible that is. Yeah, he put 20 grand in his pocket. But now I know when the coin goes to $1, he's going to say, I took 20 grand for 2 million. When it goes to $10, he may say, I sold $2 million. That's $20 million. I took $20,000 for $20 million. He was fretting, concerned about that. I said, yeah, but you're still sitting on 6, 7 million coin, man. Let it go. Okay? Don't let the greed factor overwhelm your consciousness. Okay? The idea of an asset is that you can liquidate that asset when you find yourself in an emergency situation. And that's where he found himself. So, folks, Donald said, so now you got gold as an asset. And then you got, oh, my gracious, cryptocurrency as a potential asset, and we know it's backed by gold, so it's never going to drop to a value of zero, because gold has never gone to a value of zero in the history of this country. Excuse me, in the history of the world. So, and then the third asset, your business that you are building, for those who elect to build a business, your business is an asset. Don't think your business is not an asset because you don't own a building on the corner with your name on it. Your business is an asset. You look around, you got that business paying you $5,000-$10,000 a month in ongoing residual income. You could sell that business on the marketplace for $500,000 to $1 million. It's a business. Your business is an asset. And that also is a willable part of your estate. So you want to participate in closing this wealth gap? Forget the ponders out there who are going to be on TV talking about we got a plan, we strategizing something, we putting something together, and the next year we're going to tell you how to do it, or come to our seminar, we're going to show you how to close the wealth gap. All that nonsense. I'm saying it's nonsense. All those folks are going to show you how to do it, and we've been doing it for over 8 years now. Carabao's been doing it for 8 years. Carabao's been closing the gap. When you have people on this team right now that are making $5,000, $10,000, $20,000, $30,000, $40,000, $100,000 a month, we've been closing the wealth gap for the last 8 years. And some folks are just discovering there's a wealth gap, and now they want to get on TV and talk about it. Now they want to get on Facebook and talk about it. Now they want to have summons to talk about the wealth gap and what we're going to do about it. We have the solution. We've had it now going on almost 9 years. So you have three potential assets. Within Carabao's itself, you have the gold, you have the gold-backed cryptocurrency, and for those who elect to build the business, you have the business. Folks, this is the best of every whack. See, I keep talking about the same. I know I feel like I'm selling and I'm preaching to the choir, because I want you to understand how big this thing is you have in your hand. I haven't even talked about the telephone. I haven't talked about the whim, the laptop, all the stuff that's coming. Those are part of the business, okay? I'm talking about closing this wealth gap, and everybody on this call right now, and everybody you share this stream with, they have a part, they have a chance right now. If they want to join us in this mission right now to close this gap, they don't have to ask anybody. They can start right now, tonight. No excuses. The next time you somebody talking about they want to, the rich got everything, great. You know what? They do have a lot, but we can close that gap right now. Here's the application. Fill out this thing right now and start doing some, or stop talking about it. Stop talking about it. Do something about it. Walk the walk. Don't talk the walk. And Carabao's giving you an opportunity to walk the walk, or to run the run, or to run the race and not talk about it anymore. We ain't got to sit around and talk about it. We don't have to have no black folk talk summits about the problem. We don't have to have no Latino talks about the problem in America. We don't have to have no poor white folks talking about the problem in America. Carabao's is giving you a solution to the problem right now that anybody can do. They don't care about your background, your history, your education, where you've been. They don't care how old you are. Well, you got to be 18. So all that, all these isms and all this stuff that people are concerned about don't matter. Dr. Harold Seitz has said, if you're in 140-plus countries, you can start right now to change the economics in your house. And if you're real concerned about closing the wealth gap, if you're real concerned about the haves having too much, you not having enough, and all the injustices that are done around the world, and you want to do something about it, Carabao said, fill out the application, Jack, and get in the game. Stop talking about it and get in the game. This weekend we have a big wealth builder event, okay, to help co-sponsor and raise funds for domestic violence, okay? Better tomorrows, brighter tomorrows, I'm sorry, brighter tomorrows, okay? Okay, that's doing something about it. That's actively doing something about it. For those pastors who might be listening, or you're sick and tired of having fish fries and frying chicken and washing cars, for those parents who love their little league team their son played on, or you're tired of having your kid out there dodging cars on the weekend so you can wash some cars and raise about $800 to buy jerseys, you can do something about that right now. It's called Carabao's International. I'm ranting right now. I'm on a rant. Because all this stuff has bothered me for the last 35 years since I've been in this industry. People always, well, we got to raise some money. We got to wash some cars. You got to wash some cars. Get out there and make some money. You go out and make yourself $5,000, $10,000, $20,000 a month. When your son team need new jerseys, you just buy them for him. Okay? Your church need a new roof. You go out, you go make some money, you can buy the new roof for the church. Church need a room? You go buy a room for the church. You ain't. I'm gonna leave it alone. I'm out. I'm done. Anyway, folks. Let me smile. Let me chill out. Let me chill out. Okay. We can do this. Ain't no we can. We are doing it. The fact that there are 700,000 people already in Carabao's around the world tell you that this is real, is viable. Now, here's the key to doing it. And I'm all, oh, okay, it's almost 10:30. I have one more thing I want to show you guys. Because you want to build your business, you want to build your business. Well, there are some things. Okay, building a business is this mindset. All this week, you've been hearing audios on the pre-call. For those who are plugged in, you've been hearing audios talking about mindset. We're attracting our lives to things we think about. We get what we picture. That's all you've been hearing all week. But this is not new news. Okay, this is not a secret. But I'm going to share something with you. And I hope everybody can hear me and see. I'm going to try to do it on my board back here. I hope you can see this board I got right behind me. And I hope you can see this. And I got three things on this board. I call it three stages of life. Okay? Three stages of life. And we go through these three stages. Now, I'm paraphrasing this one from other stuff I've read and stuff I've learned over the last 35 years in the industry. But I want you to understand this. Three phases. So I drew three circles. And if you can see that, I got three stages of life. Or we can call it three stages of personal growth. I want you to follow me here. Because this is critical. Watch this now. Three stages. Here's the first stage. The first stage here says family, friends, and environment. So you're born. You're born into a family, you got some friends on you, and you got an environment. That right there impacts your mental development as a child. I don't care who you are, your development mentally, emotionally, psychologically, all the things, who you think you are, your self-worth, all of that is impacted from the time you come in this planet. Literally from the time you're conceived is impacted. I really believe that from the time you're conceived, I believe it's that important. So there you are. You're being impacted by your family. What you believe you're possible and capable of doing, your family, friends, associates, brothers, sisters, all those things impact you. Then your friends and your environment. Why do some people who are born wealthy believe they're entitled to be wealthy all their life? You find somebody who's born around money, they expect money. They expect a certain thing out of life all the time. You find somebody who's born with a certain from middle class to upper class to wealthy, that's what they expect. They have a certain expectancy all the time because they were born into that affluence. But at the same time, if you find somebody who's born into poverty, they expect that too. That's why right then they got statistics show you got generations of people been on welfare since the 30s. Since FDR instituted welfare and the government assistance, some people's family have been on government assistance for the last 100 years. Okay? It's some kind of entitlement, something they bring until somebody in the family breaks out of that. But I'm gonna talk with the majority of people. Let's say they weren't born on the 1% of the income bracket. They weren't born in the bottom 10%. They're somewhere in the middle because most of us are somewhere in the middle. See, what makes society works is they stick most of us somewhere in the middle. So now you've gone through your early deformative years until you're finally turned over to the system. Now, this is a system. Okay, I don't know how soon you might get put in. Some of us now getting put in the system as early as 2 years old. We're going to daycare at 2 years old, 3 years old, 4 years old. We're being put into what I call the system. And then you get put into the system, and then the system starts to educate you or indoctrinate you or brainwash you. Whatever word you want to use, it's the same thing. You're being conditioned to do and accept a certain place. Now, this is right here. That's where most people get stuck. Because they go through the educational system, they get their friends right in the education system, they decide their career right there, or better yet, the system decides the career for them, and then they get a job. And this right here is where most people's growth stops, somewhere in this circle right here, this second stage of life. Most folks get a job at 18 or 22 years old, and they never grow beyond that circle. They never grow beyond that circle. So watch this. Then this circle is designed to make you comfortable. I mean, this whole the system and this circle right here is designed to make you comfortable. What they do to make you comfortable? They give you a good job. You get a good job. What you perceive to see a good job is relative. A good job is relative, man. Some people have a good job at $20,000. They say a good job. Why? Because nobody in their family ever made 20 grand a year. The next person say a good job is 50 grand. Next person think a good job is 100. Whatever it is, whatever your mind believe it to be, That's what it is. Okay? And majority of people, maybe 78% of the population, get right here and they stay right here. I'm not trying to distance between here. I'm saying they stay in that circle. Okay? They got a decent education, got a decent job. And the system says the more education you got, wait a minute, the more comfortable you'll be in this circle. The more education you have, the more money you're going to make on that job. The more education you have, the more secure you're going to be in that job. The more education you have, the better chance you'll have find a new job. Now, many of us are realizing that's just not true. Because there's too many PhDs and people out there with master's degrees that can't find a job or that are unemployed, okay, in trouble. But still, that circle is comfortable. And we don't want to branch outside that circle. Because when we start to branch out that circle, we deny the educational system and say, if we get an education, we're going to be successful. I heard a gentleman when I first got in the industry, he said, look, what they have discovered is the more education you have, the less chance you have of becoming financially independent. Now, see, you don't understand, I've been around now 64 years. I know this to be true. Ask yourself, how many musicians are wealthy musicians barely got out of high school? Bill Gates never finished college. Steve Jobs never finished. I mean, think about this for a minute. Think about all the folks in Hollywood that never finished school. Denzel Washington barely. I mean, think about all these folks who have become multimillionaires who did what? They weren't stuck inside that little box or that circle right there. But majority of people get inside that circle, and then how they're keeping that circle? They're keeping that circle with a false sense of security. You don't want to give this good job. Not only that, you don't want to give this good job, and you don't want to get outside that circle. See, watch this now. To get outside, I'm going to get over here in a minute. But I want to talk about the disease of this circle right here, what it does for you. They give you status. They give you titles. They give you a doctor degrees. I'm talking about them. And look, I'm not, please don't hit me. I'm not down with education. I have so much respect. I want one. I can't wait for somebody to give me an honorary doctor degree. So I'm not putting that down. Education is important. I love doctors. Thank God. I had two doctors remove my brain tumor. So please don't misunderstand me. I'm saying, but having a doctor degree is not a replacement for having money. And a doctor degree is no guarantee that you're going to become financially independent. But it can guarantee you can get comfortable in this circle. And many times you're showing a professor who got their MBA or their master's degree or a college degree. They're comfortable in this circle until this circle makes them uncomfortable. Like, don't respect their doctor degree or don't respect their master's degree. Or they got the master's degree and then they don't get a better job. Or they don't get any more money on the job. Or they got their college degree and then realize, wait a minute, this degree is not making me any more money than the guy down the street. Okay, or better yet, you find yourself making $100,000 a year, but you're still trapped. At least when Val and I graduated from school in 1977, we weren't trapped. We weren't indentured servants. Now you got students come out of school and they're $50,000, $100,000, $200,000 in debt. They trapped in the circle. Okay? That's the second stage. Now, wait a minute. Now, you're going to stay in this stage all your life unless you make a what? Choice. See, the system is out to get you from here to here and get you to stay here. This will make the system work. We got to have doctors, lawyers, accountants. We got to have all. This is what makes the system work. But in order to get over here to that freedom side of life, that side where you think different, you got to decide to be over here. And this is tough, folks. This is tough, man. I'm telling you, my heart goes out to folks who want it because I know the challenge. They got to walk through the fire to get it. But you can get it, but you got to make some tough decisions. You got to decide about your friends, your association, who I associate with. Because some of your friends, they want you to stay in this circle. They don't mean to, but when you all of a sudden you decide to get in this circle, you don't care about the NFL. When you decide to get in this circle, you don't care about the National Baseball League. When you decide to get in this circle, you ain't concerned about playing in the NBA. When you decide to get in this circle, you ain't concerned about all this stuff that people are concerned about in this circle. Now, that's the truth. When you decide to go out here and pursue freedom and independence and pursue your dream, you're no longer in this circle. Okay, and this is where you gotta make up your mind. Some folks, I submit to you right now. I've said this. Some of you have heard me say this before. Lord, okay, I'm gonna be finished in 5 minutes. The Val and I say all the time, we believe. Now I don't know if it's true or not, but I sort of feel like I was in this circle right here, and when I stepped my foot over in this circle, and none of my friends joined me in my foot. Just when I put my foot in this circle, now I had two choices. I could go back here and say, I'm over here is lonely over here. Okay? I'm going to go back over here. And still with my friends, and I could have had a job for the next 35, 40 years, and I would have been comfortable. Ford Motor Company would let me keep my job as long as I showed up to work every day. Toyota Motor Sales would let me keep my job as long as I showed up to work for them. And I could have been working there for the last 25 years. And I would have been comfortable. Okay? And I believe many times, I said, if they had all got in with me and we stuck our foot over here together, because friends like to do things together, right? If we got over together and said, ooh, this is hard, we could have all went back to this circle together, hanging out. But see, when I stepped in here by myself, Val and I did, and nobody got in that circle with us, we said, wait a minute, they think I'm stupid. No, something's wrong. I seen something. This is a better way. And I refused to go back into that circle. I said, I'm stepping over here if it means I got to find new friends. If it means I got to find new association. If it means I got to cut off the television. If it means I got to stop chit-chatting about everybody who won the football game. Now I watch the NFL highlights to see who won it, but I'm not going to sacrifice. I'm not going to watch 10 hours of football a week when I could be building my future or helping other people build theirs. That's just me. Everybody got their own choice to make. It's a choice to decide to be in this circle. They said, read books. They said, how are you going to elevate your thinking? You can't elevate your thinking in this circle. This circle is not designed to elevate your thinking. This circle wants you to read books about entertainment, not books about personal development. This circle wants you to hang out with folks who are doing what you're doing in this circle, watching TV, going to happy hour, going whatever you do in this circle, to stay average so that everybody can like you, so all your friends can like you. That's that circle. You got to take my word for it. Some of you who've been out here building a business, you realize the more you want to get in this circle, okay, sometimes you feel like you're all alone. You said, man, I like the Vic said, I had to go out and get some new friends. And you will find some new ones, but it's a decision. And most folks don't want to make that choice to go over here and start associating with different people, start reading books. Because this circle right here, you know who's in this circle? Dreamers. Dreamers are in this circle. Okay? Kevin Thompson sent me a video today, man. I fell out laughing. The video's young sister. I didn't get her name or nothing. I had to call Kevin Thompson. Said, KX. I said, 2X, is she in the business, man? He said, no. I said, good grief. Because she like came in more than 19 or 20 years old. She said, whoever created this system? She said, ain't about this. Who created this thing? Who created this thing where you got to go to work every day for the next 40 years of your life? She said, ain't about this. She was screaming. She was mad, man. She said, God got a promise. I'm waiting on God. What is he waiting on? Because I mean, she went off. You think I go off sometime? She went off. I started laughing. I said, that was me at 22 years out of college. I said, who created this system? Said, I got to work for 40 years for somebody else. I got to go to work every day. Man, I was fired up just listening to her. Okay? And the reason she has a problem with this system right here, because she's a dreamer. People who dream the impossible dream, they migrate to this circle. And as long as you stay in this circle and you're dreaming, you feel like, what am I doing? You feel like you're out of place. I had a lady week before last night, I was in Memphis. She says, I didn't feel at home until I got in networking. She said, I kept thinking something was wrong with me. She said, I always felt out of place no matter. And she had a job for 30 years. She said, but I kept saying something's wrong. And it wasn't until she got in Wellbutton's Worldwide and started associating with other people with dreams and goals and willing to fight for those dreams and goals, we found and felt she was at home. I was the same way for 6 years. I felt like I was a wandering generality. I felt like, what is wrong? I tried to make myself like the job. I tried. I mean, I genuinely tried. I used to go to work. I tried to make myself like work the job. I mean, it was okay. I mean, I had a good job to give me cars. I couldn't complain to anybody because everybody I knew, they said, man, they'd love to have my job. So they didn't understand, what's wrong with you? I didn't know until I started associating with some dreamers who said, it's okay to dream the impossible dream. It's okay to chase the impossible dream. I said, what? They said, it's okay. You dreaming of financial independence. The people in that circle, they're not. They might want to make a little extra money. They might want to be okay, but they ain't willing to pay the price to get over here. Which means they're going to read the books. They're going to listen to the CD. They're going to listen to the audios. They're going to come to Let's Go Weekend. They're going to plug in 24/7. They're going to do everything they can to get around people with a dream. And at 20 years old, when I saw this business, folks, I got turned on. Because I found my tribe. And my tribe is around people with a dream. People who don't want to be in this circle long term. Ain't nothing wrong with folks who want to stay in that circle. Please hear me. ain't nothing wrong with that circle, but you understand you've been conditioned to accept those things. So don't feel bad about being there, but if you want to unlock that condition, you start associating with people in this circle. You start associating with dreamers. You start plugging to the power call every day. You start reading the books, Think Go Rich, 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 The Magic of Thinking Big. You start reading those things, Leadership by John Maxwell, all those books, and your thinking's going to change. Your things going to elevate. You're going to be elevated, and you become a different person. All of a sudden, you have a tough time being in that circle or being in that environment. You'll go there. You'll socialize there. But the truth of the matter is, you start to breathe when you leave and get back in that circle with other dreamers. And that's what Let's Go Weekend is all about. That's what the event's all about. And that's what freedom's all about. It's about being around people with a dream and a goal. And folks, so anyway, I hope you understand. But it's a choice. Doesn't make you bad if you decide you want to stay in that second stage of life. It's okay. Understand you've been conditioned to stay there. But if you want to break out, you got to undo that conditioning and start dreaming. And start believing that it's possible to be free. It's possible, okay? But it's a price to be paid. You might have to make some new friends. You might have to leave some old friends behind. You can still love them, but they just can't. They're just not going where you're going, okay? And you got to understand that, okay? That's it, folks. Mr. Rodenberger, let me open this queue up, man, because, man, I'm cranked up, guys. I'm excited about this thing, okay? You have the vehicle in your hand. We can close that wealth gap. Yes, sir. Huh?
Now 10:45.
We got 15 minutes because we got the launch party at 11 o'clock. Okay, and it's going to be exciting.
Sergio Rizzo will be doing that tonight.
Oh, who will?
Dr. Sergio Rizzo.
All right, Dr. Sergio Rizzo. All right, sounds great to me. Let's roll. All right, open this queue up. First caller in queue as it's populating, you are live. Hello, hello, hello.
We're still waiting for it to populate,
sir. All right, no problem. Hey,
Mr.
folks, so.
I had a quick comment, sir.
Yes, sir.
I love what you shared. You know, we have here, I found my tribe in here at Wealth Builders because you say you don't have to be alone doing this business. Because of Wealth Builders, I have a whole new family, a whole bunch of new friends. And it's a life changing. So I appreciate what you shared tonight because we are experiencing that here in Wealth Builders Worldwide, sir.
Hey, look, and I'm telling you, I mean, I know folks feel like, look, I'm not saying you let go of the family you had, but I mean, you still love them, but you just got to accept the fact that you may be doing some or going someplace different that they're not going. And by the way, you may not even be able to take them with you. You can try. But it gets tiresome, you know. You know, it says easier to run with 1,000 to carry 5. You know, it's easier to run with 1,000 to carry 1. Okay, and okay. Sometimes anyway, that's man, whew, that whole
just
thing.
One super quick comment from me. Too. This is Mike Delco.
Good evening, Mr. Delco. Got to speak up a little, Mr. Delco, so we can hear you.
Yeah. Okay, thank you very much for an amazing Freedom Call as always. I promoted this call tonight. Harder than I've ever promoted a Freedom Call before because truly you've been instrumental in helping so many people find a path and the mindset to freedom. I gotta say just one quick thing as we, you know, wind towards another election. I've been listening to politicians on both sides. One side boasts that they've done tax cuts, you know, to help people have more money on their check, and another side, you know, is offering solutions, political solutions, and free this and free that. And, you know, honestly, the government is not the solution. If you give a poor middle-class mind a tax cut, they can don't spend the money. If you give a middle-class mind free tuition, they're going to spend the money. The real solution, man, is what you broke down tonight. If you get a generation or a race of people to pull together to raise funds, they're going to spend the money. It's got to be a mindset solution that changes the economic disparity in this country. So you're the freedom fighter, man. Back to you. Great call.
Hey, brother, let me tell you something. I wish I could tell you all this stuff. See, folks, understand, man, I've been a consumer of information all my life. I mean, nutcase. And I couldn't have been no more than 14 years old. And I heard Malcolm X say this. When I was 14 years old, I heard Malcolm X say, people think the solution is to give somebody something. He said it's not. He said, you can take a ghetto mind and you can move that ghetto mind to Beverly Hills. And in time, that ghetto mind will turn Beverly Hills into a ghetto because you haven't changed the mind. Until you change the mind, you're not going to change the environment. So the first thing I do is change the mind. And when you change the mind will change the environment. But if the mind's the same, no matter where you move the mind gonna change the mind into what the mind sees. And if the mind is a ghetto mind, if the mind's been raised in poverty, in lack, and in struggle, okay, in self-survival, no matter what environment you put it in, it will still function that same way in that same environment. And so I started saying, so something's got to be done with this mind. Okay, how we think, everything, how we think. Oh my God, Mr. Don't get me, man, Whew, okay. But you hear it all the time. Look, quote Malcolm X. I can quote Joel Osteen. I can quote anybody. They all say the same thing. We got to work on our spirit and what we think. The hardest we got to work on is ourselves. The money is so easy. When you start getting this thing straight, money comes. Get over things like status. Number one thing holds me back is worrying about what their neighbors think, what their family think, and what other people think about what they're doing. Man, please, let that go. You can get over that, okay? Show somebody $1 million opportunity, and they go ask somebody that's never made more than 30 grand a year what they think, and they take that opinion as fact. Next call in, Q, you are live. Lord have mercy.
Thank you so much, Mr. Best. This is Daniel Higgins calling from Atlanta, Georgia. Another amazing freedom call. Thank you so much, sir.
Hey, thank you, Mr. Thank you, Brother Higgins. Good evening. Next call in, Q, you are live. Yes. Okay, hold on 1 second. You're a little low, Miss Oliver.
Yes, sir. Awesome call, Mr. I love you all.
Hey, thank you, Miss Oliver. How old are you? Next caller. Hello.
Go ahead, Dr. Petrie. Good evening, Mr. Best. Thank you, Mr. Berger. Mr. Best, I'm going to tell you. It's a saying that says you can't teach what you don't know and you can't leave where you won't go. And every single day, you're always teaching, you're always leading where you've always been. And you know what? I appreciate what you had to say tonight, especially when it comes to family. Check this out. Joseph had to lead he had to leave his brothers only to be able to help them later. Here's Lady Lisa.
Well, Patrice, I can't go behind that, but Mr. Best, thank you so much for a real sobering discussion on how we need to start now and with a sense of urgency to protect our families, but especially it's for everybody, but the stats you gave regarding the black community, it is truly alarming. And Mr. Michael Delco, he said something to the effect that carrot bars internet, well, I put it this way. To me, Carrot Bars International is really a mindset solution for economic revolution. This business is it. And Mr. Bess, you are the epitome of someone who saw it, took action, and now you are helping everybody you possibly can to be ahead of what is to come. And I appreciate your labor. I love you and your family. I appreciate what you have constructed and the culture of Wealth Builders Worldwide. I really appreciate it because in order to be in the bubble of winners, you have created a place for all of us together, full of dreamers. You've created that place, and that is Wealth Builders Worldwide, and I'm so appreciative of it all. So thank you very much, sir. Au.
Hey, thank you. Au. Thank you to the Gordons. Thank you very much for those words. And, you know, I think it's a collective thing. We've all created this thing because there's no way. To God be the glory. There's no way. Okay. Mr. Delk and I talk about it every day. We just sit back and scratch our head and say to God be the glory, because all you guys make this thing what it is, man, because we have some like a Let's Go Weekend event. And that's why I wanted to read today, because I know we ran out of time. We ran out of time, but I had about 8 different, you know, we had this WBW pin where you get a package and roll 20 people. We send out this pin, but people send these personal stories. And every story, I had about 5 stories I'm going to read that says, I was in the business, I was sort of doing the business, and then I came to Let's Go Weekend, and everything changed. Because that's where you truly see the big picture, and you feel what we're doing, not just hear about it, not just the logic of the business, but you feel what we're doing. So anyway, thank you very much to the Gores. Next call in Q, you're live. Love you too, Dr. Nixon. Thank you very much. I'm going to say something, folks. I'm going to give, I want to transfer that. Thank you what you said, seriously. But Dr. Harold Seitz, let me just give credit where credit is due. Because I've been in this industry 35 years. I've been in Carabao 6. This is the second longest run, second longest stay I've had in any company in 35 years. Now, those who knew, you don't even understand that. But some of you who've been in 5 or 10 deals, you get it. Okay? Okay? This has lasted longer than the 3 companies I've owned. Okay? And so I give that credit to Dr. Harold Seitz because of his commitment and what he's doing. And that's why when people call me and talk about what's going on in the world of Carabao, I'm like, man, I don't want to hear it. We don't have any issues over here. We have business things that we come up with solutions for, but we don't have a problem in the world of Carabao's. And that's why I've been here 6 years, locked arms. I've never looked to the left, never looked to the right because of that man, Dr. Harold Seitz, because I looked him in his eyes and I saw that he was 100% sold out. I looked at Brick Gober, saw he was 1% sold out. I looked at Shirley Lance, he was 1% sold out. I met Boomer, he was 1% sold out. I met Tammy, she was 1% sold out. And I said, you know what? I'm going 100% sold out too. And I have not regretted 1 second, 6 years. Second run, 35 in this industry and this company. And it's hard pressed to find somebody that's been in one company. I know. Okay, out of the millions of people in the world of networking, man, finding somebody that's been in the same company 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 years, it's like looking for a Bigfoot. You don't find them. And so thank you for bringing it out. But yes, we've been fortunate to have a system that helps encourage people to give themselves time to succeed. Had that conversation there with a person in the business, Mr. Roddy White, Minister White. And he said, man, and, you know, he's been in the business for a while. Now, a lot of great things are happening in his organization. He said, but in times where he wondered what's going on, all he kept going through his mind was one thing. I said, give yourself time to succeed. Next call in queue.
Mark with Dosick, Brooklyn, New York. What just a powerful call tonight, Mr. Time Best. We thank you for your leadership. Everything that you touched on is so true. I was in service, and Pastor A.R. Bernard at CCC, he mentioned the same things. Everything you're on key with changed my life. Relational beings. The kingdom of God is now and not yet. Pattern and principle. Seek God first, God's way of thinking, doing, and being. I just had to share that. And thank you very much for your leadership.
Hey, thank you, thank you. And I'll be in New York on Strong Island in 48 hours.
I had a bad rental. I I got a van rented. We coming.
All right, let's do it. It's going to be fun, man. Wow, the Magnificent Seven. I don't know who that is, but that's what Dante Taylor said. The Magnificent Seven going to be in the house. Yeah. Next, next call in queue.
Next. Ooh, this is Dude Ushmeyer from Wisconsin.
Good evening.
I guess one comment I made, I enjoyed your show tonight, the first time I heard it. But then, I don't know why I haven't, but you said that the Care Bar has been around for about 10 years or more, and I'm just finally hearing about it this month.
Yeah.
I mean, not this month, but this year. So, I don't know. I guess the news didn't get too far out this way. But I just wanted to make one comment. I don't know who, can't remember who exactly it was that was talking, but some kind of a live video where you guys were at a restaurant, and then there's a comment that there's a lot of chocolate there or something like that. Or,
yeah.
And you're saying, yeah. Oh, I hope we don't run out of the chocolate.
Right. That was me talking about that fudge brownie, that brownie I had, that chocolate brownie I had at Papa Do's this weekend, so this past weekend, yeah. But I will say this to you. Look, I've only gotten one invitation. The company's going on 9 years old now, and I've only gotten one invitation. That's why I keep telling folks we're just getting started, because it blows my mind that you can stand on any corner in America and 99% of people you talk to don't even know we're in business, and this thing has been phenomenal for 9 years. So anyway, thank you very much. Wisconsin is wide open. Next call in queue, we'll get a couple more in before 11 o'clock, and then we got to go to the launch party with Dr. Sergio Rozelle. Next caller, please.
I'm enjoying the Freedom Call this evening, and I'm reflecting on yesterday's pre-call, which was in the power call. And one of the things that stuck out in my mind about that call was that how all countries are now trying to get away from the American dollar, and that the American dollar is really laden with debt and it has no value. So the majority of the countries now are leaning toward the real asset or the real money, which is gold. So that struck me as something very prophetic, because when you think about scripture and you think about the Bible, the Quran, it speaks about the day and time that we're living in. And the handwriting is clear. It's already on the wall.
Mm-hmm.
So most of us that have vision, we can see this.
Mm-hmm.
And if we have vision, we should be able to see that Care Bars International is really, truly the solution.
Yep.
At least for me, it is, sir. And then the second thing I wanted to mention was about when you were talking about, you know, getting degrees from college and not, you know, you're not bashing colleges.
No.
And you're not bashing getting an education, and I understand that. But one of the things that really bothered me when it comes to young people going to college and these universities is that the credit card agents, they're like vultures, and they're standing on the side and they're like reeling in these young people, and you know, they know young people, you know, they don't really think, they just, oh, I can get a credit card, but before you know it, before they even graduate, they're already in debt.
Yep.
And that's, to me, very sad, you know. And then, not to mention that, then they're laden with all of these student loans that they have to pay back.
Hey,
so
look.
Really, if, sir, that, you know, I'm so glad you brought that out, because it's really, to me, a trap.
Mm-hmm.
I think it really, to me, in a way, it's kind of, it should be the law.
Well, look.
So that's really what I wanted to add. And just thank you, sir. This has been a very enlightening evening. Thank you so much.
I agree with you. Look, I think it's criminal. I say when students come out of school now, they're no more than indentured service. And Valerie was reading an article this morning that said the average student right now will not get out of debt in their student loan debt in their lifetime. Meaning that you come out of school and you literally are an indentured servant. You're burdened with debt for the next 40 years. That's how serious it is. Okay. And so we are the solution. Last call in queue, because I got 1103. Last call in queue, because we got a roll. Last call in queue. You are live.
Thank you, Mr. is Deborah Nixon, and I just want you to know, sir, I want to thank you so much for your genuine teachings of our mission, because in Carabars, it's all about walking by faith. And you're right. When it comes to this system of education, it is also a part of the Federal Reserve and all the things that are not serving us. So people, keep mindful. Go after assets and pay attention. TyFest is teaching us what is best for networking, as well as that the Wealth Builders Worldwide is one team. We're all one people. And thank you, Mr. Best. I just want you to know that you are appreciated, and your thoughts on leadership and the manifestations of what comes after is so appreciated. Have a great evening, and thank you, sir.
Au. And thank you, Ms. Nixon. And look, I want to send a shout out to James Marshall for, man, you talking about being transparent. He just posted right on Facebook Live. He said, I graduated in 1995 and he still pay every month. We're talking 24 years later now. And he's still paying student loans. President Obama.
All participants are muted.
Didn't pay off his last student loans till 1 year before he walked into the White House. I mean, it's man, I'm telling you. Okay. My sister, Dr. Terry Best, you need to stop, Terry. She said, I'm an indentured servant, still trying to buy my freedom. Anyway, Dr. Terry Best, okay, Dr. Terry Best, we hear you. Look, folks, look, I had some fun with it. I mean, I know it's a serious topic tonight, but have some fun with this thing. You had a solution, and believe me when I say this, folks are out there, they're looking for us. They don't know they're looking for us. And what we got to do is get the courage and the conviction and the belief to know that we have the solution. Everybody's not going to see what you see, at least not right away. But don't hesitate to share this thing with everybody, 98.6 and breathing. Go out there and up the amount of no's you get. Share this thing. Plant more seeds. Get diligent about it. Dr. Sid Rosier is going to talk about that in the next few minutes. Mr. Berger. Thank you once again, man, for hosting such a tremendous call. I want to thank everybody for contributing. Thank everybody for being on this call. I hope I didn't step on too many toes. If I offended anybody, I apologize. Blame it on my head, not my heart. Blame it on my head because I'm telling some truth. And I know sometimes truth hurts when you share it with folks. And, you know, first time I heard that 95% of the population is going to be broke at age 65, man, that truth hurt me. I said, oh, my God. I thought this guy was making up some stats. I started looking around. Okay, truth can hurt. And it's asking me, what was I doing in my spare time? And I knew what I was doing in my spare time. I was watching TV or playing or going to a discotheque. And he told me I was wasting my life. It hurt. Okay, but it shook me up. So bottom line, folks, is dream big. Believe and don't let anybody steal your dream. And I'll see you at goldrocks.info in about 2 minutes. God bless. Thank you once again, Mr. Berger. Let's get some music.
Tonight. Mr. Buzz, I'm feeling led to put that live stream on YouTube so that we could share that with everybody.
Absolutely.
Tonight.
Please do.
And also, everyone, next Friday on Black Friday, we are having a Gramathon from 3 to 6 p.m. Eastern Time on goldrocks.info. So get saved up and get ready to save some gold on Black Friday.
Hey, Mr. Berger, we call it Gold Friday. Gold Friday. The consumer call it Black Friday. Well, builders, we call it Gold Friday. Next Friday is Gold Friday. Let's go.
All right. Let's do it.
Good job, Mr. Bass. Have a wonderful
evening. What'd you say, Valerie?
I say good job, Mr. Bass.
Oh, thank you. Marcus Slate Bay, good evening to you, my brother. Build your team and we will. Mr. Neen Hunter, Dr. Patrice Gordon, good night. Legendary. Legend. Ellen Brown, Burnett Johns. Montina, how you doing? Hey, Miss Edith Smith. Matrika. Stubbs, good evening. Norma Crowder. Classy T. Brown. Miss Tiffany Sutton. Erica Moore. Rachel Ride Out to Success, Bakersfield, California. It's Wanda Pinkney Lofton, gonna be in New York. Clarence Hubbard. Mr. Ricky Swenson, good evening. See you tomorrow sometime. Run right in and pick up some Team Tide Water shirts. Team Tide Water.
This session is no longer being recorded.
Good night, everybody. Take care. Bye-bye.